Today, Hamish chats with Mac from Marlivale Farm. The family-owned farm is located in New South Wales' Northern Rivers. They produce organic, rain-fed rice that has been used in Reed & Co's first Australian Rice Shochu. They discuss all things rice, from environmentally friendly farming practices to flavour, and of course, how the rice is showcased in the final shochu spirit. Let's get started.
All right. Hey, Mac, how are you going today?
I'm well, thank you. How are you?
Yeah, good. Now we can just do all the small talk. And so you've got a bottle of shochu there. This is our first shochu that we've released, which is 100% of your rice.
Great.
Yeah, I don't know if you've had a look at it yet, but we'll get to that shortly. But first, we'll just do a quick, I suppose, go over the whole concept of why we chose your product and why we've chosen to do 100% rice, Australian rice shochu as our first release. One of the cool things about shochu is it really kind of highlights the base ingredient, opposed to, say, whiskey, where we're looking at what the barrel can impart into the flavor profile, or gin, where the botanicals come in. This is, there's no hiding. It's 100% rice with koji and yeast. Single pot distilled, so we're not trying to distill out any of the additional flavors. So I think that's one of the big attractions for myself to shochu, is that it is, like, as long as that fermentation is great and the base raw materials are amazing, then it should be a good drink. And that's why when Matt from Melbourne Sake did the intro for us, which was amazing, and was telling me about your product, I was really excited. I'm like, okay, if I can get to work with these guys, this would be incredible. Your ethos is also amazing. So can you tell us a little bit about the rice variety for starters, and then the ethos, why you do it the way that you do?
Yep. So the rice variety is a Tachiminori variety. It's a Japanese upland variety. So it originates from Japan and is a dry land variety. So we sow it into the ground like a wheat or a barley. The way we farm, we're family farmers, so we're pretty small scale grain production, and compared to like rice growing in Australia, very, very small. Yeah. We essentially, sow the rice into the ground like a wheat or a barley, lots of chicken poo as our fertilizer, so we don't use any chemical fertilizers or chemicals for that matter, and essentially just let rain feed the rice, so it's not sitting in rice paddies like conventional rice growing in Australia, sort of like in the riverina. They have a lot of water being pumped into paddies to feed the rice. So in that sense, we get about half the amount of yield, but we're able to sort of give our local community really fresh grains every year, and I really feel like you can taste the difference, which makes like eating rice so nice, just being able to actually taste what it has to offer. So that's sort of our main shtick, I guess.
Sorry, just to jump on that for a second there. When you say yield, obviously is lower because it's a dry variety, but also do you know the numbers on what water you're saving by not doing it in the traditional rice paddy format?
No, not technically. I'd love to know that number. It would be huge.
Yeah, like, I was roughly, I don't know the numbers off by heart, but I was having a quick old Google search about rice growing in general, and it's the literage per kilo of rice was astounding of water, the required water to do it, like to the point where you go, I can't believe that we're doing it this way, or that rice shouldn't be grown in Australia when we're such a water poor country.
It's I guess like that industrialization trying to like maximize yield, and they do that in the riverina by essentially just pumping water out of the Murray Darling and feeding rice fields from the vegetative state of the rice, like throughout the whole process really. Whereas we only really need water after the vegetative state of the rice growing, and we tend to get that if we sort of plant around late October, early November, and usually harvest around March. So about 4 months for the rice production. And we are solely rain fed. So it sort of makes sense because we're in sort of such a high rainfall area. We're usually getting about 2 meters a year here. Obviously drought affects us entirely.
And that's, And that's what we're looking at now with the change as well, with the weather pattern coming through.
Yeah, maybe not so much this year, but I think subsequent years, like next year and definitely the following, I think it's going to be a dry year, which does affect our, I guess, growing ability, but it also just trying to like grow something for the area that you're in, opposed to just making something work by like irrigating. Essentially. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a far better ethos. And just from hand, what I found out, the smell when you steam your rice is absolutely amazing. The smell, the odor that you get from the rice.
I know, it's so aromatic, eh?
Oh, it's incredible. It's, to be honest, it's like nothing else I've handled before. I've had the same variety from a more conventional way of growing, and it really doesn't have that kind of aromatic, earthy vegetable notes that your product has. It's quite incredible. I love it.
Really comes through, hey. Even with the white rice, I think that like 10% bran still in there still really like gets that. And if you're cooking brown rice, it's like even more intense.
Oh, it's lovely. So nice.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'll have to send you some of the koji as well.
I tasted some of that actually when I was at the sake, at Melbourne Sake with Matt. Because I had something about delicious.
Oh with your rice in it? Yeah. So that one there, we grew for them for sake production. So it's non-citric producing.
Mm-hmm.
The stuff that we're using for shochu produces citric acid. And that protects the yeast. Then, therefore, we can do open fermentation for extended periods of time. We aim for about 30. And that really protects the yeast. But this stuff, at the moment, because it's so sour, it's like eating a sour lolly. It's
wow
and amazing. I'll send you some of that so you can have a look at it. My just turned 4-year-old now. He comes in a distillery and he just goes searching for it and just snacks on it.
My goodness, that's crazy.
So is it primarily just 100% rice that you're doing, or
no? So we also grow pecans.
Yes.
And we have beef cattle, and that sort of like system for us works really well because we use the cows sort of we strip graze them up and down each of the rows of the pecans. So it sort of works well on quite a rotational grazing system. So they sort of like get a strip of pecans each day, enables us not to have to mow up until like just before harvest.
Okay.
And sort of just like works well in our system of sort of rotational grazing. So we're essentially breeding beef cattle. And also works in well with our rice production, because with the rice, we are not using the same paddock each year. It's sort of every second to third year we use, because it can be quite depleting of the soil, rice growing. So we sort of rotate cover crops and green manure crops, which we let the cattle at, and also just mulch back into the soil.
Yeah. So is that like doing legumes or something to
produce? Yes. Yeah. Indeed. I mean, it's really important for us to not subsequently grow rice in the same paddock year after year.
You've come into the farm as second generation, is that right?
Well, it's my wife's parents. So my partner's parents, they've been here, they're fourth generation, and my partner is fifth.
Oh, wow. Okay. So, yeah. And it's always been on the organic.
I mean, my parents-in-law's parents, they, before we started growing rice and pecans here, it was a sort of dairy and a piggery, and that was sort of leaning towards the more like industrialized farming. But like the generation before that, it's like they've been growing organically. It's what everything's coming back to, right? Like going back to the old way of how growing things. But I guess just like the previous generation and almost like this generation, that industrialization, like chemical heavy, this can solve all your problems, has been really like marketed towards that generation, and now sort of like steering away from that again, I think.
Mm.
Yeah, but
it's exciting.
It is exciting. It's a really nice place to be, and great place to be able to like grow things. It's a super fertile area, and lots of rain, which is good usually.
Oh, Mel's just over here dancing around. So, Mac, have you had much to do with shochu or sake?
Not since meeting Matt at Melbourne Sake. That sort of like opened my eyes to what sake can be. I guess I've tasted like older style of sake, which I wasn't like such a fan of.
Especially in Australia, like it's hard when Rach and I first fell in love with Japanese food in Australia before moving to Japan. It was sake was kind of like I can give it a miss. It wasn't until I discovered like great sake that I was like, oh no, this is next level amazing. And then that was the same for shochu as well. In the shochus that I had in Australia, which were imported, were absolutely dreadful. And then it's like, you know, the next level has opened up, which is cool. So with this first release of the 100% rice shochu, when your tachimori rice came in, it was kind of an eye-opener to the aromas that your product gave off. Through the whole process of creating the shochu, the koji inoculation into the fermentation. And then with that, after the 30-day fermentation, we were finding these really beautiful fruit aromas off the ferment. So we decided there to do a single pot distillation, which is traditional honkaku style in Japan, but under pressure. So we didn't kind of want to boil off all those nice aromatics. So we've distilled this at below 40 degrees Celsius in a single pass. And it's kind of cool because if we look at whiskey, gin or vodka, we're talking about multiple distillations, which really cover up the base flavor.
Yeah.
This way, we didn't want to lose that. We wanted to create this really gentle, easy to drink spirit that wasn't too confronting. And I think we've achieved it there. So I don't know. Does it smell anything like your rice? Can you find it in there?
Not off the top of my head, but I guess I'm used to like smelling rice off the paddock.
Yeah.
More than anything, which like can vary from like pandan to again, like really just earthy. No, it's so like from like grassy coconut to like just, I guess, really earthy tones.
Which your stuff does carry through, that grassy, earthy tone, I suppose, is a better way to describe it. I can't explain how much it blew my mind. First steam in your rice, the flavors were just like, boom. This
I know it's just dry as well, right?
What's that, sorry?
You're steaming it dry, like...
Yeah, so when I say dry, it's obviously coming in contact with steam. So we layer it up. So we have a boiler below, which is forcing the steam up through the beds of rice and then pulling it out of the top of the chamber. So when the rice is steamed, it's not like your standard boiled or table rice. You wouldn't want to eat a bowl of it. It's quite dry. It is. You can see the germ is cooked all the way through. It's gelatinized, but it's dry. And the reason we do that is, especially for the koji inoculation, we want the koji to be kind of like these individual pieces where the mushroom is growing evenly right around and also generating down into the rice itself. So if we start off with gluggy rice or too wet, the mushroom will be stoked. The koji will be so happy, it will just grow on the outside.
And then we make bumps in like an individual bit.
Yeah, so this way then we can get really nice consistency through the fermentation. So, Mac, when we're talking about flavour, you've spoken about these amazing flavours that you smell out on the field of the rice. You have these earthy notes, grassy, and grassy is a great one. And then that carries across to how we receive it. And then by steaming it, we're finding that there's these amazing grassy, earthy notes as well, which are way more bright and pronounced than any other rice that we've worked with before. And that follows through the whole process with the fermentation. Those flavors grow. They become a little bit more fruity and lighter due to the koji doing its job. And I suppose that's where, you know, shochu is so exciting for ourselves at Reed & Co. is because we have to highlight that raw base ingredient because there is no hiding. We're not using other aromatic botanicals or oak influence. It purely is your rice, koji, yeast and water, and then distilled. So there's nowhere to hide. It's if the rice is crap, the fermentation is bad and the distillation is bad, then that's
kind of that's good. Yeah,
it's job done. So well done, mate. I think you're doing an amazing job out there.
Thank you.
And you've made it even harder by doing it at naturally. And wearing the loss of yield, which is, it must be really hard as a farmer to kind of to look at that and say, hey, let's lose this huge amount of our yield, but we'll reap the benefits of having such a high-end, tasty, like truly a tasty product. And thanks, because I don't think that this first release of our shochu would be the same without you.
Thank you. That's nice words. Really good.
Sorry, Mel, I went off topic.
Because I guess there's so many ways to drink it, right? You're saying like soda water, tonic water.
Yeah, tea. And it's really, it's malleable. So traditionally it's drunk with not so much the vacuum distilled because it is so light in flavour, but the atmospheric distillation is used with warm water. So through winds, a lot of people just drink warm water. Pressurised, low vacuum distillates are much better with, say, cold water on the rocks or with soda. Mm-hmm. You can drink tonic or as a cocktail base. It's also one of the only spirits that are consumed throughout a meal. Most spirits are for consumed pre and after, whereas shochu is all the way through. You can drink it all night long. But it's really surprising how little the Western world knows about shochu, even though it is the highest consumed alcoholic beverage in Japan. Outside of Japan, no one knows about it.
Less I've never heard of it until Matt told me that you guys were doing it.
Well, less than 1% is exported out of the country. Wow. So if we compare that to like tequila or mezcal, I think it's 98% of tequila and mezcal are exported out of Mexico.
Wow.
So it's kind of like almost a reverse flip. But everyone else, you talk about sake, and they're like, oh, yeah, I know sake. It's it's a drink of Japan.
What do you think the hesitation of that was? Like, why do you think it hasn't been well received?
It just hasn't. They're only now looking and trying to export it out of the country. So previously it was just all held internally. I'm not sure the reason behind that, but there is a big push now into the American market, and then that would trickle across to Australia as well. I have no idea why it's consumed there and it's not sent elsewhere.
Yeah, it's strange. Yeah.
Japan is quite interesting, though. They do have some weird laws around aging sake in barrel and the color that it can shochu and the color that it can go to protect the whiskey industry. That was an agreement that was made years and years ago with the English to protect the imported whiskey into the country, which makes no sense.
Wow.
So I think they're kind of waking up now and trying to protect their own product. So
yeah
I find it it's a really interesting beverage, and I hope it takes.
Yeah, that.
Yeah, so that's like izakayas, that's pretty much the main drink. So soda water, shochu, fruit juice.
Wow.
So your climate up there is just screaming out for it.
Yeah, yes. It's strange that like you never come across it, but great that you guys are championing it. I think it's really important.
Yeah, cool. So, it's kind of really cool. We've got like beautiful humans like Matt, who's on the other side of it as well, doing the Melbourne sake. I think that's because there needs to be more of us doing it. Like, there's no point one of us flying the flag. We all need, so the more people we can kind of get into it, the easier it'll be for everyone.
Yeah, great person to have on your side too.
Like, his world of wisdom, but also just a generally nice human being, which is for really sure. Lovely as well. Best working with them is great. Very cool. But I won't hold you up any longer. But when I do get closer to knowing a date, when I'm going back to see mum and dad, I'll give you a heads up.
For sure. More than welcome. Well, we're sort of planting, is it going to be towards the end of the year?
Yeah.
That's sort of when we're getting really into rice. So we're sort of always here around then.
Yeah, cool.
Yeah.
All right. I appreciate your time, Ed.